And join us while we sing. As soon as I get my capo on, make sure this is on. Ears are right. Okay, it's starting to quiet down here. That's good. Let's see if we can make a little joyful noise this morning.
Thank you. to receive a birthday message from legendary quarterback Brett Favre. It'll cost you $400. Want to send a spouse an anniversary message from country music superstar Granger Smith? That's only $74. Or perhaps you'd like to send your grandparents an encouraging video from Oscar-winning actor Richard Dreyfuss. That'll cost you $999. All of these celebrities and more can record and deliver a custom video message for you through a platform called Cameo. Cameo is a company that contracts and with various singers, actors, athletes, and other famous people to provide for a set price a short video of them greeting or congratulating you or a friend. There's about 30,000 celebrities that are part of this company. And while Cameo might be a neat idea, and the ability to get a personalized message from your favorite celebrity does sound pretty cool, the whole business model is based on people paying other people to acknowledge and pay attention to them. In short, while that message provides people with a kind and maybe genuine message, they aren't free. You have to pay for them. So in preparing for communion, we Christ followers should remember the lengths to which Jesus went so we could be in a relationship with him. Eternal life is free to us because Jesus paid the price. When we take the bread and the cup, we should acknowledge that we don't deserve forgiveness and we can't pay for it or even earn it. The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for Jesus and the sacrifice made for us. Today, help us to celebrate and be thankful for the free gift of your love and forgiveness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Yeah. seated. Thank you, Eddie and Van, you know. Eddie Van Halen here, you know, in red shoes.
New.
New. No, you're right. You're right. You know, for those of us who are old and grew up with the Van Halens and others, you know, a couple weeks ago when Eddie died, you know, you just think, hey, where is time going? And so it does pass, doesn't it? Hey, many thanks to you who come this morning. We hope you come to worship Christ and that you love him. Bethel had a great football year, didn't they? And last night it ended with Clinton Massey. But, you know, those that's part of it. You know, you win some and you lose some. But we're thankful that they had a great year. Next Sunday is November 1st. And the first or second Sunday of November every year for several years, we've been trying to bring back in people who grew up here to preach and teach. And next week, Brian White will be with us, and he'll be preaching in the morning. Brian grew up as a little tyke around here, and he now ministers up in Holmes County, and we're excited to have Brian with us. Also next Sunday at noon, every year, I know at least since I've been here for my 12 years, we have hosted a meeting. If you're interested and you have questions about the budget, we meet in room 207. I will be there. Some of our finance people will be there. Some of our elders will be there. But if you have a question about the budget, and just feel free to come and ask. And sometimes we sit there for 10 minutes because no one comes. And sometimes we've been there for a little bit of time because people have questions. So all of that being said, I just heard this out in the foyer. We don't do this for everybody, but I thought this was kind of special. Many of you know Charlotte Coulter. Charlotte recently went into hospice. Next Sunday is her 98th birthday. So I think Becky, her daughter, said she'd like to have people mail her mom cards. So if you'd like to mail, if you know Charlotte and would like to mail her a birthday card on her for her 98th birthday next Sunday, she is in our church directory. And we are glad you're here. And let me pray. Father, we do thank you for your church. Lord, your son left glory. He left everything to come to this world. He had everything that anyone could imagine, but he came to this world because he loved us. And Father, he came knowing full well that he would be hated by many people, but yet loved by others. And Father, we go through life and we speak boldly at times in the name of Jesus. And Father, sometimes when we speak, because we seek to tell the truth about a God, a perfect God, a holy God, who came from heaven because simply he loved us, some people get irritated and mad at us too. Father, help us to continue to love those people. Father, help us not to try and beat people up with the gospel or anything like that, but simply to present the truth, to persuade men and women's hearts that they might follow after your son, at least to investigate his claims. Father, for Jesus, we thank you. We ask your blessing on many from our church that are ill and in the hospital. And Father, we pray for those who are in recovery. And we ask all of it, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we start a new sermon series today. Called Four-Letter Words, and realizing that this is the last time I would get to speak before the national election, Kyle and I rearranged the sermon series to put this sermon today, hate. Hate, I think most everyone is going to agree, it's a dirty, nasty, four-letter word that no one really likes, and we don't use it often, but we use the word hate here and there. You might have heard about the reporter. You heard about a man that was celebrating his 100th birthday in a local nursing home. So the reporter called, made an appointment to visit with the man. And he went out and he talked to the guy. And he had a couple general questions. You know, it was one of those pieces that they do on the news. And he said, you know, how are you feeling now that you've reached this milestone in your life? And the older man, the centurion, said, you know, well, it's really kind of been a great time for me. I love everyone. And everyone loves me. And the reporter said, well, wait, are you telling me that no one hates you, you don't hate anyone, no enemies, no nothing like that? And the old man replied, yes, that's correct, that's what I'm telling you. And the reporter said, well, how did you get that to happen? It seems like there's always someone or some people that we don't like. And the old man said, well, it was actually pretty easy. He says, you see, I outlived all those people that I didn't get along with. And you know, we laugh a little bit at jokes like that, at least I do. But hate right now, you know, over the summer months, it was something. There are a lot of people, I think, that are living with this attitude, this behavior of hate. And it's become a part of people's lives. And for the most part, we sort of tolerate that attitude on a number of fronts. We think it's better not to deal with it, and we shun it or we walk away from it. Mr. Webster in the desk dictionary that I use says, hate is defined as to dislike intensely, to dislike intensely. And we all know that intense dislike is hidden in the hearts of some people, and maybe it's hidden in the hearts of a group of people for other people. We all know someone, if we push their button just the right way, that we can get them to blow up, and what comes out of them is this toxic environment that no one wants to live around. Sometimes hatred can come out in words that we choose to use, or sometimes it simply comes out in the behavior that we decide to act upon or have that day. It seems as though there's a lot more hatred being displayed now than I can remember. And I lived through the Vietnam era, and I've lived through Haight-Ashbury era, and I've lived through those times. But it seems to me, my opinion, that we live in an era of hatred. I also know that I'm not old enough to have lived through certain eras of history. In times past, millions of people have been murdered or killed simply because of hatred. And most of us, we remember from school days learning about the Nazis and the Jewish people, or Stalin and murdering his own countrymen. And I think while hate is prevalent and it's even visible in our society, it's always been around. But thanks to, or due to, whatever you want to say, social media and instant reporting like we've never had before, we see hate on display. Whole races of people have been tortured or treated unfairly because of hate. And while we know that's true, many of us, we wonder, where did that happen? How does that come about? Are we born with this natural disposition to hate people or other races or other nationalities? And I would say, no, God did not create us that way. However, we do, over time, I think, have a possibility to learn to hate. Most likely we learn this attitude or this emotion like we learn any other value. Maybe it came from the home that we were reared in, or maybe from people that we thought the world of, and we have adopted their values. Those values have been passed many times from generation to generation. And in saying all that, I have to say sometimes we're strong enough that we see that and we say, you know what? I'm not going to live my life that way. I can speak for myself and myself only. I was raised in a home where my father was an alcoholic. And I decided a long time ago, I'm not going to live my life that way. Some of you may be struggling with the thought that you know that you might have a feeling of hatred for some people, or that you've got feelings inside of you that bother you when you think of other people. And you're wondering, how did this feeling come? And you might be wondering, Dan, how do I get rid of it? How do I get rid of it? Does the feeling, bottom line, does the feeling mean I'm not a Christ follower? And if that's you this morning, I want to tell you, I can believe that you're a Christ follower, and the Holy Spirit, though, is probably wrestling with you. And that's why it bothers you when you think of that. The Holy Spirit wrestles with us, and the Holy Spirit says, come on, let's change this. Let's correct it. Sort of like when Jesus spoke to the seven churches in Revelation. You know, he wrote those seven churches following Ephesus and the Lycus Valley Road. He wrote to those churches saying, you know, this I've got in your favor, and this I've got against you. And if you read through those seven churches, you'll notice that Christ called those seven churches to change or to repent. You and I, sometimes we find in our life that there are values, that there are emotions that are out of step for a follower of Christ. And Jesus, I think, would say the same thing to us. You need to make a mid-course correction. You need to fix this. You need to repent. Just because a person is a believer and has accepted Christ, that doesn't mean that any of us are perfect. We may be standing in good shape to get into heaven, but on the other hand, all saved people struggle at times with certain sins or areas of weakness. And at times, we cave and the weakness overcomes us. And you and I are called to make those mid-course corrections. Bitterness, hatred, is one of those areas that can slowly creep into our life. And you and I are called upon to repent of it by the Holy Spirit. Not just for the sake of other people, but so that toxic poison doesn't kill us. In the passage we're going to look at this morning, I hope you'll see that you can't be a follower of Jesus, though, and hate other people. I want you to turn, if you got a Bible or a phone app or whatever, turn in your Bible to I almost said 1 Corinthians 13. That is a love chapter, but it's not the only love chapter in the Bible. 1 John chapter 4 is also a love chapter. And in 1 John 4:7, John is writing to people that he loved, people that he cared about. And John says this in 4:7-8. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. John tells us in these two verses that if you love Jesus, love will come out of you. Love will pour out of your life, because there's this godly principle, I think, at work here, that what's on the inside of us will come out through the outside of us. And so if Christ is living in you, what will come out of you? I think what will come out of you is a life and activity and behavior and attitudes that reflect a love for Jesus. Does that mean you're perfect? No. But we're able to look at people and I think see that they are Christ followers because of their gracious spirit. And I've been thinking about this for some time over the summer. I taught in our midweek study. I've been teaching since back in July when we reopened. I've been teaching on Wednesday nights, and we went through 1 John. And I compared this passage in 1 John to another passage that John wrote about in his gospel. And we see in chapter 13 that John said this of his gospel: "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you're my disciples if you have love one another." And so again, if Jesus is in your life, what's going to come out of you? The love of God. That's what's inside of you. And it will come out. It doesn't come out as this warm, fuzzy, huggy, emotional type of a spirit. I think the text beginning in verse 9 goes on to show us what love looks like. And John uses the example of the Father's love for you and me. John says in verse 9 of John 4, "This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him." John's saying, you know, people, the way God showed his love for us was by taking action. He didn't stand still. He sent his Son. Jesus left heaven. He left anything that you and I can imagine. He left it, and he came to our world because he loves someone like me, or he loves someone like you. And we know God's love shows up in other ways, But in this passage, John's describing the ultimate act of love and how God demonstrated his love and that he allowed his son to die for us. So how do you and I demonstrate love? Do you ever notice that many times people sometimes just don't make eye contact with you? You look at them and they look down, and but they don't talk to you. It's kind of like maybe they're looking past you or not wanting to make eye contact with you. And I don't know if that's demonstrating some behavior or not, but it isn't good that if you see somebody and they're trying to talk to you and you just kind of do this. The other day I went into the doctor's office. I had a mask in my hand, but when you walk in, you have to get your temperature taken. And I had a mask, I had a book, I knew I was gonna be there a while, so I had a book to read and some eyeglasses, and I had it all in my hand, but I knew first thing I had to get my temperature taken. So I walked in and I got my temperature taken, and I turned to go sit in the lobby, and there were two women there. I don't know them, but the one woman, she looked at me, and I had this mask in my hand, and while I was starting to do this, the woman said, "Sir, could you put your mask on?" And she even got the mask when she saw my mask. And she went, "Oh." And her sister, a lady with her, I know it's her sister, she grabbed her arm. And you know, I tell you, inside of me, something popped up. I wanted to say, "Lady, I've got it." But I thought, most of these people in here know who I am. I represent Jesus. What do I want coming out of me? So I just kind of smiled at her, put the mask on, quietly sat down and opened up the book that I was reading. You know, sometimes people can push our button. What comes out when they agitate you? What about serving other people? How do you do that? Do you serve like at Matthew 25? Or are you like Kyle and you work with Shepherd's Place here in town? What about helping at the minister's clothing store like Jeannie Day does and others from our church? There are many areas where people can demonstrate the Jesus stuff that's inside of them. And if you want a list of people, like maybe to visit or to call on the phone, Joan Patrick will gladly give you the name of people that we have that are shut-ins. Every month, Joan and a couple of people that help her, they package something up and they take it to all of the people and more that are from our church around here to demonstrate the love of Jesus. Some people can demonstrate love more, and we need to be careful how we demonstrate and communicate, because many of us, we look at our Facebook page and we can look at that and say, maybe that's not the best way that I should be speaking. Next week, love comes out when you communicate for people who hold different political views than you do. Now, we need to be gracious. And I was going to have everyone say, "I need to be gracious now and after the election," but I won't make you do that. John says in verse 10, this is love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. John is simply saying we need to love others with the love and the conditions that God displayed towards me and you. No conditions were really set, were they? God, we know, acted first. And what we see is God's example of loving other people. And it's not, "Hey, I'm going to love you if you love me in return." God says, "I love you. I love you." And then you and I, many times, we say to people, "I'm going to love you, and I hope you'll return that love." People, that's not how God did it. That's not how he did it. His plan said, "I will love you," and as believers, we're to deal with people in our world, whether they return that love or not. We love first, and maybe we will be loved in return. But even if we aren't, we're to continue in love towards those people. Jesus, we know, is to come out of our life when we deal with people. Like many, I have several passages in the scriptures that are my favorite, and one of them is in Romans 5:8, where Paul says, God demonstrated his love for us. While we were still sinners, Jesus died for us. Our sin was taken away. Our sin was died for before we were ever born, because God gave his life for us. In verse 19 of 1 John 4, if you skip down to it, John says, we love because he first loved us. And it doesn't matter if you are loved back. You and I are to love people because Jesus is to come out of us. In verse 20, John ups the ante a little. He says, if anyone says, I love God, and yet hates his brother, he is a liar. For anyone who does not love his brother whom he has seen cannot love God whom he has not seen. The brother and the sister that John, I think, is talking about there is people. Not your biological brother, maybe not even your brothers and sisters in the church. He's talking about people in general. So if you're a Christ follower and you love God, a God that you can't see, but you turn around and you say, I hate that person, then God says you're a liar. And I thought it might be easier to love people that you can't see. And I think it is. When Kay and I were first married, what was that, about 22, 23 years ago? Yeah. 44 years ago. When Kay and I were first married, and Dean says yes. When Kay and I were first married, I didn't hardly know her mom and dad. They lived in Felicity, and we lived out past O'Hare Airport in Chicago in Rockford, Illinois. And, you know, for the first couple years, everything was good. But Kay's dad decided that he would finally drive to Northern Illinois, where I was a youth minister, and they drove. And I loved them. You love your in-laws, but sometimes they can be a bit annoying, right? Like, yeah, danger. Danger, yeah, danger, Will Roger. But at any rate, Kay's dad had this habit of getting up at 4 o'clock, making coffee and starting to fry the bacon. And if you stirred any at all, it was like, how do you want your eggs? Now, I love Kay's mom and dad, but sometimes it's easier to love people when they are far away than when it is they're up close to you, right? John, I think, in the text is simply saying, you can't love someone if you hate other people. You can't hate other people that those people love. So in order for me to say that I love Kay, I had to love her mom and dad, 4 a.m. and all, you know? Let me give you an example that you can't love somebody if you hate who they love. Hey, Dean, it's time. Come on up. This is Dean's first appearance on stage, I think, isn't it? Yeah. You want me to give you a mic? No? No mic. Okay. You need to stand close in case you have to answer something, all right? This is my oldest son, Dean. You guys all know Dean. There he is riding a Can-Man. Can you see it up there? Yeah. Yeah. Dean doesn't ride a Can-Am, and he doesn't ride on the back of my motorcycle. No. But you know what? I still love you, don't I? Mm-hmm. Yeah? And you love me, right? Right? Dean is our oldest son. Dean is now 41 years of age, and I love him. And he loves to tease me all the time, and I love to tease him. And we tease a lot, don't we? You can nod your head or something. Yeah. What, you want me to give you a mic? No. Now, I love Dean, but Dean has some annoying habits too. But he's my son. And I love him, okay? So what if you said to me, you know, Dan, we really love you, and we're really going to miss you when you move away. But then you added, you know, Dan, while we love you, I'm really kind of glad Dean's going to be moving to the hills of Tennessee because I don't like Dean. I hate him. How would I answer you on that? Would I say, hey, you can't love me if you hate the one I love. Matter of fact, if you want to love me, then you need to love the people that I love. Right? Right, yeah. The best way to love me is to love my family. And you guys do that, by the way. You cannot love me if you hate those whom I love. So if you said, no, Dan, I really love you, but not Dean, I hate him, how would I respond to that? I would simply say, as graciously, as kindly as I can, you're wrong. You don't love me if you hate my son. So God says, you can't love me, Jehovah God, if you hate people that I love. It's a lie. You can't love God and hate the people that God loves. Are you ready to sit back down? You're good, bud. Thank you. You want the elders to pay you for doing the sermon today? That's why racial prejudice is wrong. It's unchristian. Again, how can any of us hate people whom God loves? John's saying, if you hate some people, you really don't love me. And when you think about it, how can someone say they love God? How can they say, I love you with all of my heart, and yet hate someone that God says, I'm going to let my one and only son come to the earth and die for? How can that be? John wrote in 1 John 2, verse 2, he, talking about Jesus Christ, he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for our sins, but also for the sins of the whole world. I think most of you know that I've been in therapy since July, and many of the people that I've been in this therapy with since mid-July are people of color. And I know I'm white, so I'm a person of color too. But back when all that was going on this summer, I started thinking, you know, how can I, as a believer, try to help the situation our country's in? And so even though I don't feel like I'm a prejudiced person, I decided that I needed to try and love people more. And so whether they're black or white or red or yellow, whatever, I said, God, use me. God, can you use me to extend the love and of Jesus that I feel? Maybe that will help other people get past some of the hurt that's in their background. You see, all people are important to God. All people are loved by God. But let me turn it around. What if you're the victim? What happens if you're the one who's been hurt? What happens if you're the one that's been wronged? You have to learn to forgive too. I know our human reaction is to hold on to bitterness and pain and hurt and maybe even to seek revenge at times. But when we come to know Christ as Savior, we can't do that. As a believer, we have to let go of the hatred and the pain, the bitterness. We've got to get that toxic poison out of our spirits. And the way you do that is by, through the blood of Christ and through Jesus' sacrifice for you, forgiving other people. This morning you may be struggling with the question, can I forgive this person or that person? And while you may struggle with the question, I think you know. I think you know. God can do the impossible. God can do the impossible, and He can help each of us forgive the hurt and the pain and the hatred that we might feel. But we've got to open up and allow God's Spirit to work through us. Hatred's bad because you can't love God if you hate someone. God says, no one has ever seen God. But if we love each other, God lives in us, and His love is brought to full expression in us. Let me pray. Father, thank you for your Son, Jesus. God, it's a tough sermon because all of us have feelings sometimes that run contrary to the way we know you feel about people. Sometimes we get hurt. Sometimes bitterness, the devil wants to use bitterness and it wells up within us. Sometimes, Father, the devil uses that bitterness and we allow it to exist in our heart. And we talk to only a few friends about it, but it's there. Father, help us to expel it. Help us to remember that Jesus, though he knew Judas would betray him, he washed his feet. Though he knew those Pharisees and scribes would nail him to a cross, Father, he loved them. He died on that cross. And Father, we read in the book of Acts how later many of the Jewish leaders turned and came to Christ. Father, we may not see the fruit of our work. It may come after us. But Lord, give us your spirit to love other people. Father, let the Jesus in us come out each and every day to love all people. Father, we thank you for your Son Christ, for your great sacrifice of allowing your Son to die for our sin. Father, we ask it, we pray it in Christ's name. Amen. Hey, thank you for your attention this morning. We're finished.